Good day. I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to discuss Euclid's Elements, the most important mathematics book of all time. Written by Euclid in 300 BC, it represents a summary of everything that the ancient Greeks had discovered about geometry in the 300 years before that. Euclid starts with some definitions. These definitions aren't too clear to someone who doesn't already understand what the terms roughly mean, but they do make more precise what Euclid has in mind. So he says that a point is that which has no part. So a point is not supposed to have any finite width. A line is breadthless length. The extremities of a line are points. That means he wants to consider a line as being what we would call a line segment with a beginning and an end. And many other definitions, including perpendicular lines, circles, up to parallel lines, which are defined by the property that they do not meet if they are extended. After the definitions come some axioms. So there are five sort of simple rules, logical rules, that are valid in rather a large context. For example, things which are equal to the same thing are also equal to one another. He's saying that if A equals B and A equals C, then B equals C. And for example, the whole is greater than the part. What comes next is a little bit more crucial for geometry, the postulates. Euclid's idea of how to arrange his geometry was to start with simple things and then work gradually to more complicated things. But he had to start somewhere, and he decided that there were certain fundamental facts that he was going to assume because they were just obvious to anybody. He called these postulates. There are five of them. Here are what they are. The first one is that if you have any two points, you can always draw a line between them. The second one is that if you have a line, you're always allowed to extend it in either direction as far as you want. The third, if you have two points, then you could always draw a circle whose center is one of the points going through the other point. Of course, the Greeks used a compass for that. The fourth postulate concerns right angles. So a right angle is the configuration made by two perpendicular lines. We usually use that symbol for perpendicular lines. So there are two right angles, and the postulate is that any two right angles are the same. And what does Euclid mean by that? He means that if you pick this up, you can superimpose it on the other one. Generally, when Euclid says two things are the same, that's what he means. He means you can pick one up and impose it on top of the other one. And then the fifth postulate, by far the most contentious one, and the one that developed a lot more geometry coming from it later on, is the parallel postulate, which says that if you have a line at a point not on the line, then there's exactly one line that you can draw through that point which is parallel to the given line. So after this introductory material, Euclid starts with the books. There are 13 books, or we might call them chapters, and they deal with various issues. Most of the books are with geometry. There are a few that concern number theory. Let's have a look at some of the content with an especial focus on those things that are important for logical setup of foundations. So the first proposition is the construction of an equilateral triangle on a given base. So suppose you're given that line there, and you want to construct an equilateral triangle on it. Well, what Euclid says is that you put your compass there and draw a circle through that point. That's using the third postulate. And then another circle centered here through the other point. Then these two circles meeting here give us an equilateral triangle. And already with this first proposition, we have an example of a place where Euclid cheats a little bit, because he does not have a postulate that guarantees that these two circles necessarily meet. It's obvious from the picture that they do, but it's not actually logically a consequence of what he's set up already. That's going to be a recurring theme in Euclid, that if you look carefully, there are assumptions built in aside from the ones that he's already formally acknowledged. There are many other propositions. The last two in this book are concerning the most fundamental theorem in mathematics, that of Pythagoras. And it's very important to understand how Euclid thought about Pythagoras. So here's a right triangle, meaning that these two sides are perpendicular. Pythagoras is a statement about three areas, areas of squares built on these three sides. So we call these three areas Q1, Q2, and Q3, because the ancient Greeks used to like the word quadrature. And Pythagoras' theorem says that in such a situation, this area, Q1, plus this area, Q2, equals this area, Q3. And the other proposition, 48, is the converse, that if this relation holds, then there's a right triangle there. Book 2 deals with what we would call geometrical algebra, with algebraic relations like this, which in Euclid's time were expressed geometrically. So a plus b all squared equals a squared plus b squared plus 2ab was represented by a geometrical figure like this. Proposition 14 shows how to solve a quadratic equation, or find a square root. If you have a rectangle with sides a and b, the problem is to find a square that has the same area as that rectangle. So we're looking for an x such that x squared equals a times b. And here's the solution. You extend this a length of b so that this is equal to this. Then you draw a circle with this as the diameter. And from here you go up perpendicularly to where you meet the circle. Again, we assume that we actually do meet the circle. And then this distance here is the one that we want. Book 3 deals with circles. There are famous theorems. For example, here is a circle. There's a chord on the circle. And here is the angle subtended by that chord at the center. And here's the angle subtended by that same chord at a point on the circumference. By angle, the ancient Greeks did not mean what we mean in terms of 37 degrees or 54 degrees. They meant rather just the configuration consisting of the two lines or two rays. So that was an angle. It was a geometrical configuration. So when Euclid says that this angle is twice this angle, what he means is that you can split this angle up into two pieces, both of which are congruent to this one. There's no actual physical measurement system taking place here. By the way, this theorem is not exactly true all the time. If this point here is on this side, then it's no longer true. And so Euclid has to separate these two cases. Another interesting phenomenon having to do with angles that the ancient Greeks worried about is this idea of a horned angle. If you have a tangent to a circle at a point like that, then Euclid knew that you couldn't fit any other line in this little green area between the circle and the line. But nevertheless, this kind of curved angle, which they called a horned angle, has some claim to being non-zero. So the Greeks were a little bit ambiguous or confused about how to treat angles like this. Next time, we're going to look at Book 5. Book 4 is just inscribed polygons. But Book 5 is particularly interesting for foundational issues having to do with irrational numbers. It deals with Eudoxus' theory of proportion. So I hope you're going to join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.